As I indicated before, this is going to be the section on the connecting rod. Now, this is not a casting, it's a stamping, and it's very well done. The only thing that I've done with this is just take a little file and clean up the flashing just a little bit. But this is a brass stamping is what it is. Now, at first glance, this seems to be a somewhat challenging piece to machine, but in reality, it's not. What'll happen is, this is all one single piece. There's a couple of critical points in here. One critical point is, looking at it from this side here, from the side view, this hole right, there's going to be a hole here that has to be through, and then there's a hole here. This is going to go to the piston rod, which was, you know, you just saw that being built a while ago. It's going to have a little clevis in it in one of the things, but it has a little clevis. And this is the part that goes into the clevis. Come back over here. You can, I don't know if you can see that in there or not, but this part, well, let me get this engine here over here. This part right here is going to be connected up to the bottom of this connecting rod. Or if you can see in this engine here, that hole right there is what I'm talking about. And then, of course, you've got one down here for the crankshaft hole. Well, those two holes have to be parallel to each other. If one of them's cocked up or anything like that, it'll run in a bind. So the important thing is these holes here must be parallel to one another. Otherwise, you'll have to adjust this connecting rod to where you'll have to have slack in this end down here to offset that, or to take up for that little offset right there. Either way, you get a little knock when it runs, so you don't want to do that. If you get it in there, you know, it doesn't hurt anything, but it's better to just have it as parallel as possible. Now, in order to do that, one of the things that you're going to have to do first is you're going to have to drill a hole before you cut this apart. Now, this is held with bolts. This connecting rod here is held with bolts. So there'll be two holes that's drilled all the way through, just like that. Now, once those holes are drilled through, then you come through, or I'll come through, and then I'll cut that in half. The reason you drill your holes and you cut it in half before you bore out where the connecting, or where the crankshaft goes, is if you bore this out before you cut it in two, all right, so you bore it, then you cut it, your hole will no longer be round. And then you have to line it all up and do everything all over again, because you're not going to be, in other words, the space of your saw is going to clamp down on your connecting rod. So, first operation is drill two holes for the connecting rod, where it goes together. Of course, you want those to be as parallel as possible on that. Then, it'll be cut in two. Once it gets cut in two, I'll go to the four-jaw chuck, and the four-jaw chuck will be boring this hole right here. Now, of course, at that time, these two pieces will be bored, bolted back together. Also, at the same time, or when I finish that, I'll also have to bore and ream a hole out for this side, this end right here. So it's not a complicated piece, but there's several things that you have to do in a specific order to make sure that it works correctly. So I'm going to go over and get started cutting this in two. There's several ways you can do this. You can do a slitting saw on the milling machine, which I'm not going to do. And there's many reasons why I'm not, but the main reason is if I were to put this in a vise this way in my vise, my slitting saw won't go past that, or I don't think, maybe it will. I'll have to go over there and set it up. Matter of fact, I think that's what I'll do. I'll just go over and set it up, and then we'll see on the milling machine how the slitting saw works on this. That doesn't work. You can also just take a hacksaw, don't worry if it's a hacksaw. You can do it. I've done it before many times, or not many, but I've done it several times. And then you just come to your milling machine, and then you square off those two pieces. It's just be careful, take your time. That's all you have to do. So I'm going to go to the milling machine and see what happens next. Okay, as I continue with the connecting rod, or the con rod here, I've got it laid out, and just a simulation there where the crankshaft is going to go through. Then I just took a mark a lot, blacked off the ends, and now I've got the holes positioned where I'm going to drill them. Now, you know, they've got special jigs, and I don't have any of those. So if you guys are out through there with limited work and you need to do things like this, you gotta, what I do is I plan ahead. So I've got this vise. This is not a genuine machinist vise, but it's a nice vise. It's an American made vise. It's Paul Graham, I believe is, well, I think that's what it is. P-A-L-G-R-A-M, something like that. Well, whatever, you know, you can look it up. It's in the catalogs. But all these machinist vices have got a slot in the back. Well, if you look and you see how this connecting rod is made, you've got one axis going this way, and that's where your crankshaft is going to go through that way. And then you got another one that's where your grunge pin is that goes up here that goes to the piston rod. So my operation is, first, I've got to drill my holes. So the holes will go down through each side of this. Now, how am I going to get those holes straight? Well, ideally, you'd have a jig and a bunch of vices and expensive money and so forth. And like I said, I ain't got none of that. So, what I'm going to do is take this vise, which is fairly accurate, and I know that this pin right here is pretty much in the middle of this vise. That's the screw. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this square, and I'm just going to line it up to this jaw, which I do know is straight, and I'm going to bring it right up next to that screw like that. I'm just going to scribe a line, and I just took a mark a lot and hit the top of that vise. Then I'm going to turn it back over this way. Well, I can actually go the other way. Well, let's turn it over that way. I like doing it that way. See both sides of it. So now we'll hold that flat against it, and I've got that side of it. So those two lines right there are pretty much at the center of the vise. Now I gotta put this up to go in there. So I'm gonna put this right in here, and I'm gonna get this part here centered. And of course I'm gonna take it off camera here in just a minute to make it final. But I'll bring that up just like that, and I'll get that centered, which it's not. Now let me put this down there to put it up on so I can hold it a little bit better. Get that top part centered. All right, that looks pretty good. Now, to double check that, I'm going to go get, well, I can actually use this right here. This will give me, and see that, well, first thing I want to do is I want to look down up under here. Got to do that. And then I want to get this centered and make sure I'm straight down here. That's pretty straight. I'm just looking right down the axis this way, right down there so that you can see where that knot thing is. So I've got that, and now I've got this top part here lined up in the center of the vise, and I'm just checking it. You know what? It's not quite. It needs to be over just a little bit more. Well, after quite a bit of fiddling and fussing, I was able to get it within 2/1000ths of each other. So that's pretty good. And of course on the bottom, I'm just lining it up right straight down through the middle of that. So now I'm going to be drilling an 1/8 inch hole through there, because that's my clearance hole on my bolt. So I'm going to take this to the milling machine and I'll set it up. Now the way I'll do that is, because I have this protrusion right here in the back and the bottom of this, this will be set up on two parallels inside the milling vise. In the milling machine. I'll take you over there and I'll show you how that looks. Now what I'm doing here is, after I get it cleaned up, is I'm just going to drop a parallel on each side of those, and then that vise is going to go in like that. Get everything squared up and snugged in good. Okay, I've got my this little vise set up on some parallels that are in there, and that's what's holding that down. Let me go ahead and retighten that up a little bit, make sure it's in the right place.
getting that set down. That's nice and snug. Now I'm just going to use my wiggler to line up my screw holes. All right, so I've got that one lined up. So now I'll just swap it over to a center drill, and then I'm going to drill through with a 1/8 inch drill. All right, and that, gentlemen, is how you drill holes when you don't have the right stuff, but you got some stuff. And that is a perfect hole straight through. Well, if I can get it undone here. Yep, that is straight through, just like it's made for it. So now I'll take it back over to the workbench. Next operation is to cut it in two and then start boring out the middle of it. Now, one of the things that you'll want to do right now is to go ahead and put some witness marks on it. So I'm going to be putting a witness mark because I'm going to saw it in two. It'll be sawn this way across this line right here. So I need to put a witness mark on it to make sure that I get everything lined up when I go back together with it on the same side. So wait, I just punched that punch right in my thumb. Goodness gracious. That's not good. That is not good at all. Okay, well, we're going to wrap this one up. Sorry for the blood, guys. I'm going to go in there and get a Band-Aid. Safety first in the shop, and I did not do it. Should have known better than doing that. All right. I'm going to be back out in the next video. Well, I just got back from getting patched up, and what happened was I was using one of these spring-assisted punches like this, and as you saw, I was using this connecting rod right here, which has a curved top on it, holding it with my finger and my thumb and pressing down on it at the same time. Stupid. It wasn't my sharpest moment by far, especially with the whole time that I'm talking and I'm on camera and I'm looking at that vise that's like 6 inches out of the camera view. And I kept thinking, I need to put this thing in the vise because it might slip. No, nah, it won't slip. And sure enough, it did. So the point is, you know, just take an extra few minutes in the shop. I don't think that you need to go crazy. I don't think you need to do like the government does and get involved in everything. Lord knows I don't want the government involved in revising this safety punch that's been on the market for years and decades. You know, I want them to stay out of my shop 100%. I'll take responsibility for my own oversight. And that's the way I've always been. Not looking to be a victim, not looking to blame anybody except myself. Again, what happened was when that thing slipped, that punch went right to the bone. So it went all the way through, made just a little bit of indention, but it did bleed quite a bit. But that punch, it ended up hitting that bone in that thumb. And man, you talk about hurt. It hurts. So I'm going to probably lay out of the shop for a day or two till I get my feeling back in my thumb a little bit, and then we'll just start back up. But I'm posting these videos now about once a week anyway. I usually try to get them up on a Friday. So until the next time, when my thumb gets better and the connecting rod gets back in the videos, this is John from one side of a two-car garage in the great state of Texas. We'll see you on the next video.